Sure.
Good evening, all of you. A very pleasant day. Fortunately, the rains have come down, at least on the side where I stay. Welcome, all of you, to the Power Hour session with Sign. Today, we are on the fourth session. We're running this Power Hour series by getting some of the best speakers. We've been fortunate enough to really address the startup and decision makers, really get to think what to do next. So we've so far conducted about sessions to help startup entrepreneurs and decision makers to really interpret and deal with the challenges which are emerging out of typically functional areas like finance, marketing, funding, technical areas like medical devices, regulatory aspects, etc., from the current crisis situation. But however, today's session is slightly very different because the focus is on the leadership skills of the startup entrepreneurs, the decision makers, not only of startups, but also SMEs and various other organizations. You may be aware the theme of today's session is leadership during turbulent times. So the analogy I can really think of is like a captain of the ship navigating towards stormy weather, where he has to sail the ship through deep seas. Today, I think most of the decision makers, along with the startup entrepreneur, is like a captain of that particular ship, having to take agile decisions, probably a balance between heart and mind, in terms of what does work against the stormy weathers. So I think we are really fortunate to have a very well-known speaker, I would say, somebody who's done extensive work in the leadership space, Mr. R. Ramkumar. Mr. R. Ramkumar is the founder of Leadership Center, an organization dedicated to building world-class thought and practice in the domain of leadership consulting, research, development, and so on and so forth. A leadership center also is like, I think, a four-year-old startup. So I think there is a lot of commonality between startup owners and Mr. Ramkumar and his team. We are also fortunate to have his colleague, Aparna Nair, with us. Mr. Ramkumar was with ICICI. He retired as an executive director on the board of ICICI Bank and various other ICICI group. Prior to which, he was with Hindustan Aeronautic Limited, Hindustan Unilever Limited, and ICI. Ram, popularly, he's called as Ram, so I'm also going to refer to him as Ram. Ram has published his first book titled Leveraging Human Capital, A Practitioner Perspective. And he also writes on his blogs regularly. Welcome to the session, Ram, and also Aparna Nair. We are really honored to have you on this session. The format of the session, as we move along, for the benefit of the participants and the panelists, Ram would take over from where I leave just now, and he has gone through. There are a plethora of questions which have come in from our participants. So based on that, plus his own insights and experience, he would take us, share his experiences on this particular theme. Post which there will be a Q&A session where the participants who are, real time with us also will have an opportunity to, ask questions. So there is a Q&A section in the screens you're looking at. So please feel free to write your questions as the sessions move on. Just before I hand over this to Ram, for those of you who are totally new to Sign, because we have some regular visitors who attend the webinars, plus we do have some new visitors. Sign is one of the oldest technology business incubator as part of the IIT Bombay Powai system. We are 15-year-old incubator focusing on deep technology. We focus on innovator startups from idea to scale up. We provide incubation support. So as we speak, Sign, to its credit, has supported more than 160 startups with over 500 startup entrepreneurs who in turn have generated about 4,000 plus employment. So that's a little brief about Sign. Over to you, Ram and Aparna. Thank you for this.
Thanks, Ganga. And thank you, Poini. And thank you, Rakesh, for giving this opportunity. And thank you, Sign. Let me tell you what we did actually. Hello. For a brief moment, I thought I lost my connection. What I did was that I have gone through all the questions you all have sent. So I always believe when we engage with other people, we should not engage with other people basis what we want to say. We should engage on the basis what people want to know and engage. So I have gone through all the questions and they seem to fall into five themes. So the themes are, one, a broad theme where many of you have asked, what are the leadership abilities in general and what becomes more important during a time like this? So I will address that as part of my structure. The second piece is that when we find ourselves in the middle of so much negativity around us, how do we create positivity? One, how do I as a leader stay positive? And two, especially when I'm required to make tough decisions which are impacting people in a difficult manner, how do I keep the motivation of all the people around up? That is the second theme which I will address from a group of questions. The third theme which comes in, as I as a promoter, leader and a CEO, I'm alone and I feel under pressure. And during this period, how do I manage my own self-doubts, my own difficulties, which I have to get over so that I can make decisions with clarity and I can see the world around me in a uncolored lens? That's the third theme which I will address. The fourth theme which I would address is, during this time when I have such difficulty in terms of access to funds, how do I prioritize and decide on my resource allocation between various functions and between the present and the future priorities? The last but not the least is how do I balance managing the immediate in this challenging time and yet be focused, rather than focus it, having sight into opportunities that are there in the horizon? So these are the five broad themes I would touch upon. So let's first start on this. I believe leadership is one of the over-mystified concepts. We end up really putting leadership into a perch which is beyond too many people. In my mind, it is important that we humanize leadership and we make leadership sound to people as that anybody in the world who chooses to exercise leadership will be able to do it. Success or failure, proficiency will grow as I practice leadership. This is like any other skills and perspective. So at Leadership Center, we look at leadership through the lens of what do people expect from leaders? And when is leadership required? So as the two Harvard professors, Marty Linsky and Ronald Heifetz, in their book, Leadership on the Line, I happened to be in a program with them many, many years back, said with a very simple man, what is the difference between, on an everyday basis, we are called upon to solve problems. Don't see problems as difficulties, right? Challenges. We are called upon to deal with challenges. most of the challenges and the problems, we are able to solve it and by applying known knowledge, knowledge known to us, known processes, known methods, known systems. And when you do it, you are able to solve them. Like, how do I take my product to the market? Where do I find access to funds? How do I organize my team? For all this, there is a playbook. So where there is a playbook, and if I apply the playbook, it's fairly certain or highly probable that the intended result will happen. That's what these people call as a skill, we call as managerial or management skill. However, while we engage with it, there are problems and challenges where the known knowledge, rules, processes, methods are not sufficient enough for us to solve them, for us to engage with them. The playbook for it, at least I don't know, even if it exists in the world. And there are sometimes, there are challenges where the playbook is not available in the world also. So when we engage with these, not only us, the people who are with us feel they are engaging with something which is ambiguous. So there is no clarity on what drives what. What if I were to bring on the table, the outcome will happen. So there is ambiguity about it. There is uncertainty about the result. Even if I were to apply this, is the result reliably certain? Or the result is uncertain? What degree of uncertainty exists? Third, people feel that ambiguity and uncertainty, when they come together, complexity also comes along with it. Grasping the context itself becomes complex. The context itself becomes complex. Leave alone the rules of engagement. So, Marty and Ron made a proposition. These kinds of problems, they called it as adaptive problems or adaptive challenges. And the former ones, where the playbook is available, they called it as technical challenge. When you are facing a technical challenge, managerial abilities would suffice for you to engage with it with reasonable success. But when you are facing adaptive challenges, managerial abilities may not be sufficient enough. So that is where leadership ability comes. So in their book, whenever we create clarity where there is ambiguity, whenever we are able to size up the uncertainty and lay a path to deal with the uncertainty, we exercise leadership. Whenever we simplify complex constructs to ourselves, to other people, we exercise leadership. It is not necessary that all the time you need to do all the three things. Even if you do one of this, you are exercising leadership. So now tell me, why is it that leadership becomes important in turbulent times and not important in other times? In my mind, whether there is turbulence, whether there is no turbulence, Ganga's analogy of steering the ship in a sea is leadership. So let's take an example. I'm a bit of a storyteller, so bear with me. So 26th of January, 1967, at NASA, Houston, three astronauts get on to the command service module of Apollo 1. Gus Grissom, Ed White, and Rob Schaff. These are the three people who go and sit on top of the Saturn rocket, which was called Apollo 1, to test the command service module for a flight to moon. Apollo 1, right? Apollo 11 was the one which landed on the moon. Please remember it. So when they got onto it, at about 11 a.m. in the morning, they've been testing for 4 hours. Many things are not working, and these people are frustrated, and they are sitting inside a sealed facility tube which is saturated with oxygen. And by the passing hour, they are feeling irritated with things not to the extent where they expect it to. Then 4 hours into it, at 4:01 inside the capsule, Ed White presses a button to do a test, and suddenly there is an explosion. And within minutes, the three astronauts are, one, suffocated, two, burnt to ashes. Now, if you are the NASA director in charge of this mission, Chris Kraft, how would you feel? So COVID is not the only turbulence organizations or institutions face. Every organization, whether it is NASA, ICICI, Hindustan Unilever, or a pharma company, or Google, every one of them, big, small, startup, all of them go through problems, turbulence. When does turbulence happen? When you have lost your bearings. In a three-axis bearing, suddenly you are not able to control the pitch, the yaw, the roll. That's what happens in an aircraft, right? Every time you fly. Now, what is leadership? Leadership at that point of a time is able to cut the clutter and not get overwhelmed by the whole environment, but learn to focus on your ship and your aircraft to take control back. Now, what happens in a COVID kind of a situation? Every one of us have blown up our problem to the size of the problem of Mr. Narendra Modi. Mr. Narendra Modi has to solve the problem of the nation. You and I have not been called upon to solve the problem of the nation. You and I have been called upon to solve the problem, first, of our family, second, of our company. So the trick here is to contain the problem. That's what NASA did. NASA has to sit down and find out. It cannot imagine that this is the end of the project. They cannot imagine that everything in the Apollo 1 design was faulty. They had to come down quickly and understand what was faulty, what if I were to fix, and there is no playbook available. Nobody has gone to the moon before. Nobody has built a rocket to go 500,000 kilometers one way, come back 500,000 kilometers another way. Nobody has built an inertial guidance system. These are the years of 16-bit computers. Right? To have 100 kilobytes is a big one, leave alone gigabytes. It is in this world the NASA people have to deal with. For more on this, listen to a podcast called 13 Minutes to Moon by the BBC. So I don't have the time to tell the full story, right? So the bottom line is, never magnify the problem. Never look at the problem bigger than what it really is, as it impacts and affects you. The moment you start magnifying the problem beyond what is relevant to you and how it impacts to you, you will get overwhelmed. That is when you as a leader will lose the balance. When the pilot loses the balance, there is no hope for him to use the gyroscope. Gyroscope can balance the aircraft, the ship. But if the pilot is not in control, it is of no use. So that is the challenge of leadership in turbulence, is scoping the problem to manageable proportions. So at Leadership Center, a small company, last year we closed the financial year with 9 crores of top line in the fourth year of our working. We have a facility called Kautilya, 60 room facility. Now, if I as a leader sit down and worry about how do we contain COVID in India, whatever is happening in Maharashtra, I will waste my time. I have to sit down and ask, what part of the problem at this point of a time I can manage, I can comprehend? That's one part. That is management. Second, what part of the problem I can deal with by shaping something? That is leadership. So we quickly understood that Kautilya, the facility, is a part of the problem we will not be able to manage, because nobody for the next 9 months will come into a classroom or come into a hospitality facility and trust that there will be no infection. So as far as Kautilya, we can only manage at this point of time. However, when we come into Leadership Center, which is where we do our knowledge business, we sat down quickly and said, hey, why do we believe learning can happen only in a physical classroom? Why can't we create a virtual classroom? Especially when you have Microsoft Teams, which permits, and other software, I just took one software name, Zoom, WebEx, right? Wherein I can actually recreate classrooms, breakaway rooms. Now the question we have to ask is that, what do I have to do with my content so that I am able to adapt my content to a digital platform? Innovation. How do I innovate? What do I do with my pedagogy? Meaning, the way I teach. And how do I create interactive learning like what would have happened in a small breakout room? How do I modify my exercises and what you all will call as games, which can be digitally run in a group? How do I make people believe that they are sitting in one room? As you are hearing to this webcast, none of you will in your mind think that you are sitting alone, right? I don't see any one of you on the screen, but I can see all of you. And on last count, I saw there are about 80 participants. Right? And I feel like I'm speaking to all of you. So we have to work on how do we adapt to the new reality by innovating, by being prepared to give up some of our old comfort and habits, by looking for and making new networks and alliances, by finding the first few supporters and evangelists who would come and play the game with us. By I, Aparna, Murli, Diju, all of us learning a skill to talk to a computer screen as if we are talking to human beings in a full classroom, and without our voice or without our emotions in any way being less. How do we adapt this platform? And you will be surprised if I were to say, yeah, initially we would have been happy to just break even in the months of April, May, June. April we broke even. This month I will make profit. We have lined up a slew of business. Now we know that from next month and the month after and the month after, we actually can now look forward to really increasing our surplus, which is the profit, in the leadership center business. So to me, the big point which we have to ask is to say, how do I manage ambiguity, my ambiguity tolerance? Am I a person who prefers certainty? Do I want data for everything? Or am I a person who's an explorer, experimenter? Do I have the right level of entrepreneurial risk appetite, which is the same as leadership risk appetite? And how do I bring it on the table? How do I make it calculated risk taking? How do I not moan and groan about what is not happening? This is not the year to do performance management. This is the year to be able to talking to your team, saying, how do we crunch our innovation cycle to 30 days? What new at innovation should not be invention. It is bigger than Kaizen, but smaller than invention. So, if Silicon Valley can have an innovation cycle of 90 days, why can't I have small innovations rolling out every 60 days? That innovation could be a process innovation. That innovation could be a fund structuring innovation. That innovation could be an infrastructure-based innovation. That could be a product-based innovation. But making it manageable size of bits and not boiling the ocean. This is not the time for looking at time frames of 5 years. In turbulence, a pilot is looking to get out of the pocket of turbulence. A captain of the ship is looking for calmer waters, not the port yet, not the airport yet. So that is the key. So in a turbulent time, time, Einsteinian way of looking at theory of relativity, time collapses, space collapses. Now you understand containing the problem? Contain the problem, then the space collapse. then you get focus. This is not the time for the big picture. This is the time for you to carve out in the big picture, the core picture. What is the core? You have to have clarity. And if you are not having clarity to find the core picture, seek out people and have conversations with them. It is by having conversations with other people, we create different perspectives and we challenge our own perspectives, and what looked like there is no answer, suddenly options appear. I am no evangelistic speaker. So hence, it is important to find allies beyond the set of allies you already have. You cannot solve this problem on your own. You need other people. Create a network where you could share and see whether people have the common problems, and you can pull in resources now so that the resource allocation bit is shared right now. Five companies coming together, solving a problem common for all the five companies. Rather than five companies independently solving the problem. New alliances is going to be the key. Now, when you ask the question, right, what do I do when so much negativity is around us? Can you have a greater negativity than being an Apollo 13? You are 200,000 kilometers closer to the moon, 300,000 kilometers away from the earth, and another 500,000 kilometers to come back. And suddenly you find you have had an explosion, and your fuel and life support, which is oxygen, is venting out into the out of the spacecraft into the space. And suddenly you find you are left with 100 amps of power. 100 amps of power can run a hair dryer for 3 hours. What can 100 amps of power do? Run a hair dryer only for 3 hours. Now what do you do? So when I had an opportunity to interview the great James, Captain James Lovell, who was the mission command, who was the flight commander on Apollo 13, I asked him, Captain Lovell, when this happened, what happened? He said, for a brief moment, we held hands, we all cried. Because they are human. We all ask the good Lord, we haven't done anything so sinful that we should die in this cold space with nobody, leave alone our family, no other person from the earth anywhere near us, and we won't even get a decent burial. What wrong did we do, great Lord, for this misfortune to fall on us? Normal for anybody to go through this. Self-doubt, anxiety, feeling all is lost. None of us are facing a problem of death right now, right? None of us have personal terminal illness, right? None of us are dealing with that. The challenge is running our company. And many of us started our company with nothing. And yet we brought our company to something. Yeah. So our position is better than Captain James Lovell. So then Captain James Lovell told me, Ram, they were all US fighter pilot trained people. They said, thereafter my training kicked. Immediately the three of us started taking an inventory on what they call as how would we survive this. They quickly knew that three of them sitting in the spacecraft could not survive on their own. So then they had an ally in the ground, Gene Kranz, the mission commander, controller, sitting at Houston. So together they come together and say, right, all is not done because we are still alive. The spacecraft has not disintegrated. We still have life support left in this. We may not land on the moon, but with this spacecraft, can I come back to Earth? That is called reframing the new objective. If any one of us running business right now in the COVID were to say, I will not alter my objective, alter my vision, and I have it what I had pre-COVID, then I can only wish you well. You should be pragmatic enough to sit down and say, can I resize my ambition for the next 24 months? Even that is longer. Can I look at how I will come out of it 30th June 2021? Then can I break it down into 5 quarters? Then can I break it down to 12 weeks every quarter? Then can I break it down to 24 hours every day? Then do I know what do I have to achieve at the end of the day, at the end of this week, at the end of the fourth week, at the end of the first quarter? That's all stop now. Then when you get past that quarter, then look at the next 2 quarters. When you have gotten past 1+2, 3 quarters, now you have the luxury to look at the next 4 quarters. When you come out of that, at that point of a time, in good health, may not be prosperous wealth, you know you have come out of the pocket of turbulence. The aircraft has come back to your control. The ship has come back into calmer seas. From there, you can reset your ambition. If you are a sports person, which I was in my time, right? I used to play kabaddi for my states. I used to run 400 for my state. One of the fundamental things we sportsmen learned is if you have a hamstring tear or an injury, your first objective is to get fit to play. Because only if you are playing, you can win. You cannot win sitting on the sidelines watching other people play. So in a turbulent period, personal or institutional, you crunch your objective to that core objective. 2-3 core. Now resources allocated predominantly to this core objective, yet you carve out a little bit and say, I am putting this for my exploration and experimentation as innovation. I don't know what is the proportion. I will lie to you. Each of us have to suck and see and put that, depending on the access to fund we have. If you have no fund available for innovation, please first allocate fund for staying alive. That's what the human body does. When the human body has a choice to really send the blood, the heart, it first sends it to the brain. It's okay if the other parts of the body is starved. Then next, it sends it to the lungs. It prioritizes. So clarity. Without clarity, ambiguity will not. Without clarity, you cannot deal with uncertainty. Without clarity, you cannot break complexity. Scope, core, size, both space and time. Also, what you seek to achieve. For example, we cannot get 9 crores on 31st of March 2021. If I don't have to get into my cash credit, I should be generating every month anything between 12 and 13, 15 lakhs. So my first objective is to find business to get 15 lakhs. So if I end the year with 2 crores, I still would have made profit. And in my mind, I know this is a year I, as a sports person, have been injured. So my focus is getting fitness back and not dreaming about winning the World Cup. Even if this happens to be the World Cup year, I'll have to wait to play the next World Cup. Shikhar Dhawan, I can't do much about it. So that part. Now coming to making difficult people decisions before I hand it over back to you for your questions. This is not only in turbulent times you make difficult people decisions. For those of you who have never made difficult people decisions, this will be challenging. But for people who have, while running the business, made difficult people decisions of letting go of people who are not performing, who are not culture fits. So for them, I really don't think it's a big challenge. Now, for example, take my own case. At Kautilya, our facility where we run is a training facility, 60 room we have. A 60,000 square feet facility, invested my personal capital in it. A lot of money, 30 crores invested into it. Now, if I keep worrying about it, I will go nowhere. In the best of our times, we had about 30 people working in Kautilya. 30 for the facility. Cooks. Boys who are in the restaurant, boys and ladies who are doing housekeeping, gardening, right? Effluent treatment, the whole set of it. It would have cost me during my steady state, simple cost of running Kautilya was 15 lakhs for me every month. I and my team sat down and said, how do we bring it down to run that place at 3.5 lakhs to 3 lakhs. So we had to come down like the heart saying, where do I send the blood to? Now what did we do? So once we have decided this is how we will do, who are the people we will keep and who are the people we will let go? What would be the communication to the people we let go? We have not done it yet. The people we let go, we are going to tell them, we supported you for 2 months by paying you salary when we had no revenue, but we honestly not be able to support you for the next, we don't think this problem will go away in the next 9 to 12 months. If this problem were to go away in the next 3 months, I would not have minded paying you the salary. But for 9 to 12 months, I don't have the money to pay the salary, even if I wanted to. So when we come back on steam, you will be the first set of people to whom we will give employment, provided you at that point of a time are not employed elsewhere and are happy to come to work for us. Equally, if any one of you were to have a serious medical emergency during this period, we will support you, because that one requires humanness to do. Beyond it, I hope you guys understand. There is no other way. There is absolutely no other way. Trust me when I say this. I'll close this and hand it over back. In 1993, I was in Kolkata running a factory, Asia's largest tea factory for Hindustan Unilever in Kidarpur. That factory had 1,350 employees. We were producing 20,000 tons of tea. However, in 1993, it was one of the oldest factories for levers. The cost of producing a ton of tea in that factory was to the tune of 4,500 to 5,000 rupees. Newer factories which had come all over India for Unilever were producing tea at 1,000 rupees to 900 rupees per ton of tea. Production cost. Now, I was summoned to back my headquarters. At those days, I was the head of manufacturing and I was also running the human resources, the state called personnel. I was asked to shut that factory. We had three unions. Young Mamata Banerjee was one of my union leaders. I came back. The labor minister of Bengal, Shanti Ghatak, was my union leader from CPIM. Some of you know Kolkata, the Naxal hunter Lokikanta Basu was another union leader. I called all of them and sat down and told them, I was very young those days, I told them, sir, this is the problem. I can run this factory productively. If this factory can produce 20,000 tons of tea with 400 people, we would bring the cost down to about 1,800 to 2,000 rupees per ton of tea. I then would be able to convince my headquarters not to close the factory. Otherwise, violence, no violence, strike, no strike, the factory will shut down. Because nobody can run a factory at five times the cost of anything else. I want to tell you right now, as we speak in 2020, Kidarpur factory is still running, making tea with 210 people. They are making, on last count, about 40,000 tons of tea. We didn't shut that factory. Of course, we did not go to 400 people. In stage one, we went to 700, and in stage two, we went to 400. So part of leadership is also to be able to communicate to the people why your decisions are still saving, protecting, and helping a set of other employees. But if you didn't make the other one, we would have lost everything. So we are not making these decisions to benefit only the promoter. We are making this decision to benefit as many employees who we can save. This is almost like when a ship is sinking and you have lifeboats. If you have an option, you can carry all of them. But otherwise, it's foolish to say let everybody sink. So we have to save a few people. And that is not easy. Don't expect that people will cheer you and think of you as a hero. But trust me, years later, the people you save will remember you. And they will say, That was the right decision made. Yeah. Though I didn't answer each of those five questions in a sequence, you would have seen I woven through all of them into this. Now I hand it over back to you for your questions.
Thank you, Ram.
Questions only, it can be comments also.
Yeah, so thank you, Ram, for the insightful session. I'm requesting my colleague Rakesh to read out a couple of questions which have come up on the chat.
Sure. So Kanchan Dwivedi, she's asked, very well explained about the role of self-control in leadership, sir. Her question is, how does a leader decouple attachment / emotions from decision made so that the leader can let the project go if required?
So don't run the project. The first rule I always followed, because I ran, apart from human resources for ICICI, the technology function, the operations function, the innovation function, and the quality function. When my boss, my board asked me to run the innovation function, I asked them, I'm not running the business. I'm not running retail bank. I'm not running corporate bank. I'm not running any of them. Why are you asking me to run the innovation? So my managing director told me, Ram, that is how you will be dispassionate. So hand over some of these projects to other people. Sure, you will participate in it to make some decisions. But if you don't run them every day, automatically you become detached. If you run something every hour and every day, you will find it very difficult to really stand out and look at something through the eye, which is a critical eye. We call it endowment effect. An endowment effect is anything I do, I overvalue it to be good. So you say this project is not mine. This idea I am not doing. Somebody else is doing. Then it becomes easy for you to critique it. When we say critique, we are not saying run it down. We are only saying examine it in a detached manner. I find it working if I do it like that. Again, I'm a storyteller. So every time when a major project came to my hand, I would always find some other person who's a smart person and hand over the project to them. And they say, you run the project. I will stand outside. Of course, I will review the projects, but I won't run the project. And especially when you're a small company, it was easy for me in ICICI. However, when I am in leadership center with a small company with 10 employees, it's difficult for me. And some of my colleagues are in this webinar. Diju Shali runs my online business. You can ask her. I never mess around. I say, Diju, that is your business. Come to me when you want counsel. Otherwise, you go and make your calls and you choose to really interact with people inside and outside who you think you need to interact. However, when you come to me, right, at that point, I might offer to you my perspectives and my inputs and my critique. There is no other way. I saw Mr. Kamath doing it brilliantly. Whenever you went to Mr. Kamath and ask him a how question, he would always turn around and say, find it. And then tell me, then I will tell you whether there is more to it. He was always forthcoming with the why question. He will never give you the how question. Sometimes he will help you think through what. How? Never. Back to you, Rakesh. Hope this helped.
Thanks for giving the perspective, Ram. We have Sir Rajiv, who has raised his hand. Can Swati, can you unmute Rajiv Kangamam? Hi, Rajiv. You can ask a question.
Hello, sir. It was very in terms of leadership skills, what are the leadership skills required for startups in East and Northeast. And it was a eye learning for me because everybody needs to have some leadership in order to engage the people. But when we are going in a different areas, so we need to have different leadership.
Rajiv, can you type out your question, Rajiv? Because your voice is cracking. Yeah, if you can go to the question mark, and if you can quickly type out your question. I will definitely answer it. Even if I am unable to do it, Ganga will connect me to you on a phone. I will definitely answer your question on the phone.
Sure, sir.
Try to do it right now. So you can type out, Rajiv. Meanwhile, we can take one more question.
Ram, there's one question, little generic, from Pradeep Kumar Suryavanshi. He says, how to build a productive and reliable team? I think you've covered, but you might just want to give some important insights.
It's an interesting question, right? As always, I say, how is a very difficult thing. How I will do and how you will be different. Yeah, but let us ask the question, what are the characteristics of a productive team and what kind of a leader is likely to put a productive team and what kind of a leader is unlikely? A productive team has a characteristic where people, the culture of a productive team is that people feel accountable to outputs. People honor the promises they make to each other internally and externally. People are not resource guzzlers. They try to get more out of existing resources rather than asking for, give me more resources. We call it resource leverage. A productive team is a team which sets standards of excellence. They don't say any outcome is good enough for me. They would always say this outcome is good, is the best outcome for me. And a productive team brings high level of mental stamina and physical stamina. Accountability, honoring promises, resource leverage, high excellence, setting standards of excellence, bringing in strong mental and physical stamina. So, as a leader of the team, it is your job to articulate it to the people and build that culture. Leaders who are not demanding, leaders who do not expect high standards, leaders who are not results oriented, hardly ever build productive teams. Productive team will be a team which would have what I call as a dynamic tension. But that doesn't mean you will threaten, abuse, or ill-treat people. A productive team is a team where the expectations which are set are challenging. And whoever does not measure up to it, having given a certain time, would have to exit the productive team. So unless your team has a learning orientation And unless you as a leader, as a nurturance orientation, you cannot build productive teams. Do I see a question from Rajiv? No. Or am I? No, I'm not able to see it. Okay.
I think he's probably will have you connected offline on that. So, I Rakesh, are you able to see any more raise of hands, or maybe I can read one question?
So we have a question. It's an anonymous question. So you mentioned about networking and solving a common problem together and benefit together. But when we look at the current situation, we have actually hit a reset button. So how do we are the first in the market? So not compromising on a lot of factors as an individual company in the long run.
I would only do. See, morning I was speaking to a CEO of another company. I was basically telling him, if you have the resources, right? How big is not important. If you have the resources, organize currently your company into two groups. A larger group of people who are dealing with your company staying fit and alive during this very challenging, difficult time, so that they are focused on the cash flow. The moment cash flow dies, your company dies. So there has to be a strong set of people who have strong execution skill, strong drive, pushiness. Never say die spirit. Resilience. Identify those people. And those are the people who should be driving the present for you. And amongst your people, pick 4, 5, 6 at best of people who you think are imaginative and thoughtful people. Get them to work on alternatives to the current mode of doing business. And you also start speaking to an extended set of people in the environment. Ask them question, this is the business I am in. How do you see this business emerging a year from now? What is in this business will become redundant? What in my business would still be relevant a year later? What are the new things which I should start building today in my business so that when the market opens up, I am ready? So these 4 or 5 people should be meeting people, speaking to them, finding these inputs, and you along with these 4 or 5 people doing a conversation, discussion, pooling practically every week, and at the end of every week, identifying a couple of projects, innovation projects, which one of these 5 person will be taking responsibility to drive. So you will have to straddle the world of today and yet have this eye on the world when it opens up 12 months from now. But because there is a challenge of resource allocation, you have to do it in a wise manner. Sometimes these 5 people may not be available within your company. Maybe this is the time for you to go to sign and ask them, are there people in IIT Bombay, professors and students, who I can borrow to do this job for me? So look at an extended universe beyond your company for you to innovate. Because the extended universe cannot execute the present. But the present can be executed only by your people. That clarity you got to bring in your mind. Who executes my everyday? Who do I nominate to prepare my company for the opportunities which may come 12 months from now? For which I need to start building capability or prepare for it. Hope I was able to help.
Yeah, sure. Rakesh, are there any more? I think Swati said there's somebody who's raised hands. Swati, anybody? Who's the person?
No, ma'am. Now,
okay.
No, okay.
Yeah, okay. I think, so we overshot the time, Ganga, so I don't know whether Ram has any time limit.
Don't worry. Right, I will be there till the last person has something to ask of me. It's an honor that you all gave me. It's an honor that so many people have given their time to be in this meeting. Yeah. My time is not more important than the time of 80 other people.
Thank you, really. Really appreciate, Ram, your time, because we know how you are busy. You had session in morning, session in your, like, you know, entire, amidst all this cyclone, you are still taking sessions, so we know about all this busyness. Yeah, one thing I would like to tell the audience, because they are still there, and then Ram and Aparna has come forward and, you know, offered us their online platform, leadership platform, to be used by our teams with absolutely no cost, at least to begin with, two months. So please, and then we are formally launching it. So Ganga and Aparna are going to work the details out, and then we will share the details with you. Try to make maximum, you know, leverage out of it. There are beautiful videos and leaders who, like, you know, talking over it and giving lots of situational concept. And on top of it, Ram also has added his perspective. So this is what I wanted to just share with all the participants here. And Ram and Aparna, I really appreciate this, value addition to sign in this, like, especially during this turbulent situation. This is really coming very handy for us also.
Sarah, thank you for giving this. And I really want each of these people who are there, entrepreneurs and business leaders here, to make use of it. Ganga, some of them have said that they would like to meet me or speak to me. I don't know.
Yes.
Yeah. All of them, you can share my phone number.
Sure.
It will not be a problem, right? It would be my pleasure to personally engage anybody who wants to speak to me or engage me. I would be very happy to.
Sure, sir. We'll surely do that. Yeah. So with that, I think we are good to close. Thank you, Ram. Thank you, Aparna, for really taking time out. Poinis explained it very nicely. Thank you, participants. I think without you, we wouldn't have had this session. We almost touched about 80, 81, and we had about 100 or 150 plus registrations. This part of, I think in terms of the company, your company and Kautilya, etc., we can always share the contacts with the 2V participants, and we'll ask them to directly get in touch with you. Thank you, participants. So we end today's session. I think one big takeaway for me from your session was time to look at the core picture. I think that's what we need to do in the next couple of months. That's a big takeaway. Next week, we are going to have another Power Hour with another interesting speaker. So you will again get back with more questions and more interesting insights. So keep in touch, stay safe, take care. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.